Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fallen Woman, the true story of Linda May Spencer, Madam, Maven, Mother, by Allison Mann, with Linda May Spencer and Emily Jean. Narrated by Charlotte North. There is nothing left for me here. Three slices. One, two, three. One on top of the other, starting at my wrist. No one wants me. My family is gone. I'm completely alone. This will be better for everyone. Maybe I'll see Mom. If she went there. If I go there. There are broken pieces everywhere. Mementos, symbols. Of what? They mean more smashed and broken. Like my life. Like me. I'm getting tired now. I've always been tired. Tired of living. Tired of needing, craving, fighting, fleeing. If I fall now, I won't get up. If I fall now, I won't wake. I'll be gone. Gone from all of this. Is this what I want? Blood is dripping from my arm, running down, staining the floor. Blood stains are how my life began. Will they be how I end? If I fall asleep, I will not return. But if I don't, if I fight to stay, if I change my mind, can anybody catch me? Will I ever be more than broken, more than fallen? Introduction. Linda is nothing like I expected, and yet exactly what I imagined. She walked into the coffee shop for our first meeting, dressed in blue jeans and a bomber jacket. At first blush, I thought, nope, not her. Then I noticed the beautiful young woman next to her, the one who had first reached out to me, her daughter, Emily. When you get that kind of email, you do your research. My mother owned and operated two saunas/brothels in St. Paul, Minnesota, from 1976 until a very controversial and publicized court case in 1997, when she had to eventually close her doors, Emily's email had begun. I vividly remember reading that message and immediately opening Google. Linda May Spencer, MN, I typed. The search didn't return much. A 1993 Minnesota Court of Appeals case, City of St. Paul versus Spencer, was all I could find. As a longtime paralegal in the Twin Cities, I recognized more than one of the names listed in the case, both lawyers and judges. The case was about a public nuisance dispute in the City of St. Paul. I saw the facts of the case mentioned prostitution and misdemeanor convictions, and my interest was piqued. Not seeing much more in my Google search, I moved on. Social media being the next logical place to find out more about the woman who had emailed me and her potentially felonious mother, I jumped on Facebook. Once again, there wasn't much to find, but what I could see was a profile picture of a woman named Emily Jean. So there I sat, an email message, a court case, and a photo. This information conjured images and scenarios in my mind, as it would anyone's. Heidi Fleiss, Moulin Rouge, fur coats, diamonds, and of course my personal favorite, Pretty Woman. It was important that I'd been able to confirm a few things. Emily existed. A woman named Linda May Spencer had owned and operated saunas in St. Paul, and there had indeed been a court case. It wouldn't hurt to meet them and find out more. Sitting in the coffee shop, waiting for Linda and her daughter, was surreal. I looked up every time the door opened. I'm certain I appeared as if I were waiting for a blind date to arrive. I was nervous, excited, and just a little bit scared. Who was I about to meet? I felt my excitement rising as the woman in the bomber jacket and her daughter walked toward the table. This lady may not have been famous, but there was certainly potential that she was infamous. I couldn't wait to learn more. From the moment she sat down and started talking, It was clear that Linda Mae Spencer had lived life. Her voice was hoarse and gravelly, her eyes dark with experience. What she lacked in glitz and glamour, she made up for in grit and wisdom. If I had been unsure of the legitimacy of the story I read in that first email from Emily, all unease fell away in the first 10 minutes of meeting Linda. Emily sat next to her mother quietly at first. She listened as we talked and prompted her mother from time to time on details she'd left out. I didn't hear the whole story that night. Time wouldn't allow. But Linda painted a picture in broad strokes. She had been a wife, a mother, and a businesswoman, not unlike me. But just below the surface was a long, dark tale that would take twists and turns almost impossible to believe. I wanted to learn more about Linda Mae Spencer. I wanted to know her daughter and hear what it was like to grow up with a mother who owned brothels. I wanted to use my knowledge of the law and the courts, my skills in investigation and interviewing, but most importantly, I wanted to tell this story. I wanted to open the long-shelved files in the courthouses and city halls, the police files, and memories of the people who lived through this, and piece it all together. I wanted to tell the story of Linda Mae Spencer, a woman who had fallen, a fallen woman who, remarkably, sat across the table from me in a coffee shop that night and began telling me how she got up. For the next year, I spent hours with Linda. I learned about her story, her business, and her family. But I did more than just listen. I researched. I searched databases, libraries, courthouses, and police files. I read transcripts, court documents, and reports unlike anything I had seen before. From her narrative and those of others who documented the events in real time, I've been able to weave together this remarkable portrait of a woman and a time rarely talked about today. Many of the events in this book may be difficult to read. The impact of the struggles, the crimes, and the trauma cannot be fully conveyed without honoring the truth and the darkness within them. In many cases, names have been changed, as indicated by an asterisk, to protect the privacy of those involved. Oftentimes, women involved in sex for money transactions used an alias they had chosen as a work name. These names have not been changed. Reports from the St. Paul Police Department contained detailed and often graphic documentation of the events which occurred. Much of the dialogue in this book is taken directly from reports as written. In a few instances, dialogue was derived from narrative presented in the reports. Downtown St. Paul is quiet. It has an old, slow feeling about it. As you walk the streets of the city, you can look around and see history. Cornerstones mark dates of construction back to the 1800s, while brick buildings with tall, still intact archways lead to libraries, museums, and theaters. St. Paul thrives with Midwestern culture and boasts a rich history. The capital city of the state of hockey has many claims to fame, including F. Scott Fitzgerald, Charles Schultz, and perhaps most important, St. Paul, Minnesota, is the birthplace of Scotch tape. And while you can tour St. Paul, greeting Lucy, Linus, and good old Charlie Brown, what you don't see on the corners, in the buildings, or in any storefronts, is a history far different than cartoons and post-it notes. While Herb Brooks coached his hockey team, while the Minnesota Twins won 2 World Series, and while the famous Mall of America was being built just a few miles down the road, a dark, secret industry was thriving in the city of St. Paul, and officials were desperately trying to shut it down. Throughout history, many monikers have been given to buildings where one could go and pay money to have sex. In today's world, we are familiar with terms like Bunny Ranch and Whorehouse. But dating back to the early history of the United States, and specifically St. Paul, these buildings were called houses of ill repute, bordellos, brothels, and massage parlors. But as society and laws evolved, So did locations formerly tucked away in red light districts and hidden alleyways. In the early 1960s in St. Paul, through the end of the 1990s, a person wanting to purchase sex need only look for a sauna or health club to satisfy his desire. Storefront saunas were located all around the city, and inside them, an illegal business thrived. Part 1. Chapter 1. Walter Spencer raced up the Santa Monica freeway. He had to strike the perfect balance between speed and stability. The blood bank gave him just enough to transfuse his newborn daughter, Linda May, but he needed to get the pouches there fast. The baby had been born hours earlier, and the doctor said she needed a full blood replacement. Because Linda and her mother had incompatible blood types, her mother's blood had transferred antibodies through the placenta that were now attacking the baby's red blood cells. Linda was being poisoned by her mother's blood. He had to get there in time, or the baby wouldn't make it. Arriving back at the hospital, Walter ran to his trunk to get the pouches of blood to bring to the doctors. He had made it in record time. He knew as he opened the trunk that he would always be credited for saving his daughter's life. He liked that. Now, there were bloodstains in the fabric of Walter's trunk. Tiny little spots of dark red soaked into the carpeted space. If someone didn't know to look, they would never even notice the spots. But Walter would. He would always know when he looked at those spots that it was Linda who ruined his car. Tall, dark, and handsome, Walter Spencer was 30 years older than his wife, Margaret. She had easily fallen for his piercing green eyes and British accent when she and her girlfriends arrived in Los Angeles from St. Paul a few years prior. Margaret had been in search of sun, sand, and Hollywood. She found all of that and more in Walter. He was a bit part actor and loved to talk about himself. Walter had spent his life using his looks and personality to win people over. He may have been a con man, lying about being everything from a chiropractor to a professional boxer, but Margaret didn't see it. She fell in love, and they were married not long after they met. Linda was the third child born to Walter and Margaret Spencer, but she was not the last. In total, the couple had 6 children together prior to Walter's death in 1956. After her entrance into the world, Linda Spencer continued to have a rough life. Her birth had been traumatic, causing both a lack of oxygen to her infant brain and the need for a total blood transfusion. Because of this, Linda suffered a number of neurological problems. Not only did she have difficulty in school due to learning disabilities, she also suffered physical setbacks. Nerve damage caused Linda to have an uncontrollable jerk in her arm. Without warning, her arm would flail into the air, oftentimes causing a disruption around her. Kids at school teased her constantly, and she was, without intent, a distraction in her classrooms. While Linda's mother did seek help for her daughter by way of special schools and medical treatment, she never explained to young Linda what it was that made her different. Margaret would take Linda to doctor's offices for treatments, leaving her there alone with the doctors and nurses. She did not stay to comfort her young child or explain what it was that would be happening to her. She simply left her frightened child with the doctor. Linda never understood why her body moved in the ways that it did, different from the other kids, or why she sometimes had trouble understanding things in school. Where a mother could have educated her child to help comprehend and accept her differences, Margaret left Linda to wonder. Margaret was cold. She never offered comfort or love to her children. While she provided for them in the form of food and shelter, she did not wipe their tears or care for them when they were ill. She did not share things with her children or talk with them. Margaret was a secret keeper, always hiding her own feelings and never asking others to share theirs. Chapter 2. Nestled in the hills of Malibu, California, was the home where Linda Spencer began her life. The house was no bigger than a shed with a decent-sized yard. It was a tiny space that housed all 8 members of the Spencer family. While basic life necessities were provided for the Spencer children, they did not have the things other children their age did. While their friends had toys to play with, Linda and her siblings were given parts of turkey carcasses to keep them entertained. Their father slaughtered turkeys and gave his children the claws with tendons still attached. When Linda pulled on the tendon, the claw would open and close. While other kids went to school in freshly pressed clothes, Linda recalls many days where she didn't wear underwear under her dress because she didn't have any clean to put on. For his part as a father, Walter Spencer did not pay much mind to his children. Linda's memories of her father are limited, recalling him drunk more often than sober and heavy-handed with her mother. She remembers a particularly scary experience when her father lit her mother's bathrobe on fire after tying her to a chair. Linda and her siblings watched in panic as their father laughed at their screaming mother. When he left the room, Linda's older brother put out the fire and untied their mom. No one ever spoke of it again. Linda grew up fearing her father rather than respecting him. Walter's main goal in life was to become a Hollywood actor, and in the absence of that, he used alcohol to fill his emptiness. From time to time, Linda can remember her father getting bit parts on television, once acting as a judge in a courtroom scene. She remembers Walter making all of his children sit to watch as his big moment flashed on the television. He was so proud of himself and demanded the same pride from his children, although Linda, in particular, was hard-pressed to give it to him. Walter did many frightening things in the eyes of his children. Linda remembers his violent treatment of animals that would come into their yard in California. If Walter was outside when a cat made its way onto their property, he would lure the cat in. After calling to his children to come see the cat, Walter would hold it underwater in the small kiddie pool that sat under the tree in the backyard. Once the cat stopped breathing, Walter would hang it from the clothesline for the family to see. Contrary to how her father wished it to be, there was no fame or fortune in the Spencer family's Malibu life. Eventually, Walter's drinking caught up to him, and in 1956, when Linda was 5 years old, he died. There was no fanfare when she lost her father. Margaret had taken all of the children to the hospital one evening. Linda remembers seeing her father in the bed. He was completely yellow. Her mother told her and her siblings to say goodbye, and so they did. Linda did not understand that this was the kind of goodbye that would last forever. She didn't know her father would never come home. She said goodbye as if it were goodnight, and never saw her father again. Although there was no more abuse, no more yelling, and no more drinking in the house, things did not improve. Suddenly finding herself the single mother of 6 children was difficult for Margaret. She needed to find work to support herself and her children. Eventually, she found her way to the police academy in Los Angeles and began taking classes. Once she graduated from the academy, Margaret began looking for work. Being a rookie and a woman led her to the only job she could find, a night shift as a guard at the LA County Jail. The work was tough, not only the hours, but the physical demands. Margaret was injured many times, once leading to dental surgery and the extraction of nearly all of her teeth. It was during this time that Margaret herself turned to drinking. Instead of being mean and angry like their father, Margaret would become quiet and sad when she drank. Linda hated seeing her mother with a bottle because she knew that meant her mom was going to disappear into her bedroom for hours and hours. Because of their mother's job, the Spencer children grew up largely unsupervised. Margaret slept during the day, leaving her young children to fend for themselves in the dangerous world of the Hollywood Hills. On summer days, they would find their way to the lagoons on the ocean front, or up into the mountains above. Spending days running free was not exciting for Linda. She felt scared and exposed during these times. Linda lived with the constant sense that danger was lurking around every corner. Linda recalls more than one occasion when she was escorted home as a child by police officers, busted for running through stores without shoes or playing with matches in the dry underbrush of the forest. Linda and her siblings often found themselves in trouble. The police scolded her mother for allowing her children to run around the way they did, but there wasn't much she could do. She explained to them that she had to work nights to keep food on her table, and because she worked all night, she needed to rest during the day. She knew this wasn't ideal, but it was the only way she could support her children. Police officers were quick to advise Margaret that leaving her children unsupervised at night and allowing them to run like they did during the day could lead to the county taking them away from her. So, Margaret was forced to find a babysitter who would take the youngest 5 children at night, where they would be safe while she worked. This would alleviate at least part of the risk she was taking while trying to provide for her family. Every night on her way to work, Margaret would drop her 5 youngest children at the home of a woman she barely knew. Before the days of licensing or background checks, Margaret had no choice but to trust the woman to keep her children safe. The babysitter had a live-in boyfriend who would also be there when Linda and her siblings arrived at night. This man was big with blonde hair, and he smelled terrible. While the babysitter herself spoke mostly Spanish, with the occasional broken English, her boyfriend was easy to understand. 7-year-old Linda understood every word he muttered as he lay on top of her night after night. She knew exactly what he said as he whispered in her ear, "I will kill you," while he forced his body inside of hers. She knew what he did was wrong. She knew that no one would come to help her. But she also knew that if she told, life would just get harder for everyone else. There was no sense of security in Linda's life. She never felt safe or loved during her time in California. Life was chaotic and scary all of the time. But there was one person in her life she could count on, one source of ease among the tension. This was her oldest brother, Walter Spencer Jr., nicknamed Abby by his family. Perhaps it was the years between them or his calm demeanor that made Linda feel so safe, but she always knew when Abby was around, things would be okay. She loved being close to him whenever she could, watching him play baseball games or hanging around him at home. By the time Linda was 8 years old, Abby was suddenly scarce. Weeks would go by without Abby coming home, and when he was home, he was in his room alone. She constantly asked her mom where her brother was, and he was always somewhere else, at a friend's house, at baseball, on a trip for school. Linda hated when he was gone. Abby was the only male in Linda's life whom she truly trusted. He had become a security blanket for her, and without him, she felt helpless. Linda was about 9 years old when her mother told her and her siblings they would be moving to St. Paul to live with their grandmother. Linda was relieved. Even at such a young age, she understood that moving away meant stopping the abuse she was suffering at the hands of the babysitter's boyfriend, and she looked forward to being cared for by her grandmother. For Linda, this was a great hope for her life to start getting better. Maybe Abby wouldn't play baseball when they moved. Maybe he wouldn't be with his friends so much because all of his friends would still be living in California. But when Margaret Spencer and her 6 children got on the plane headed east, she kept one life-changing secret from them. Although Linda and 4 of her siblings traveled together on the plane, their oldest brother was noticeably absent. "Where is Abby?" Linda asked her mother on the plane. "Don't worry about it," her mother told her. It would be months before Linda heard about her brother Abby. Linda and her siblings were taking classes at the Catholic Church to receive their first communion. Their grandmother had required this as a condition of Margaret bringing her children to St. Paul to live with her. During a class, Linda spoke to a nun about her family and talked about her favorite person in the whole world, her big brother Abby. One day, Sister Mary Dolores sat the Spencer children down under a tree outside of the church in St. Paul and told Linda and her siblings that their brother had died. He had been diagnosed with a brain tumor while they were still living in California. Linda didn't understand then, but all of those times when Abby was gone, he was in the hospital getting treatment. Her mother had hidden the entire illness from her children. And, as it turned out, Abby was on the plane with them that day. He was in a coffin in the cargo hold, in transport to his final resting place in St. Paul. Linda knows now, as a mother herself, that it was probably the unimaginable grief of losing her son that led Margaret back to Minnesota, back to her own mother, to a place where she wouldn't feel so alone. Chapter 3. Despite her great hopes, life was not better for young Linda in Minnesota. Her mother continued to work as a police officer, and she was forced to live with her mean and nasty grandmother until they were able to get a house on their own. Where she had previously been left to roam free, now Linda was under the forceful hand of a grandmother who was strict and oftentimes physical with Linda and her siblings. Linda and her brother and sisters attended Garlow Elementary School in St. Paul. This was a big change from the special school that Linda went to in California. Now she was with the regular kids, and she was expected to learn and act like they did. Linda struggled, but no one seemed to notice. She muddled her way through classwork, getting average grades without specific help for her learning disabilities or physical differences. There was never anyone in the Spencer home checking in on the children. Linda didn't come home from school to a mom asking if she had any homework. She rarely even brought home a book. No one encouraged her to try hard or do her schoolwork. She just did what the teachers told her to do. No one ever asked Linda what she wanted to be when she grew up, or gave her any direction in looking toward the future. Linda skated through school largely unnoticed. At Henry Sibley High School in St. Paul, Linda Spencer found friends. She'd been somewhat of a loner in elementary school, sticking to her siblings and rarely interacting with the other children. In high school, this changed. While she didn't fit in with the preppy or smart kids, Linda found a home with the troublemakers, the kids who skipped class and smoked marijuana under the bleachers at the football games. By this time, Margaret had moved her children into a home not too far from their grandmother, but the teenagers were free to come and go as they pleased. Margaret rarely paid much attention to their whereabouts. To her, it was only important that they went to school every day and once they were old enough, got a job. For the most part, Linda was once again free to roam. It was during her high school years that Linda met Beth, who was a kindred spirit. Beth lived in a similar situation, with little supervision or direction in her life. Together, Linda and Beth started finding trouble when they were just 14 years old. Because neither of them had someone at home paying attention to what they were doing, Linda and Beth could easily sneak out at night. Beth introduced Linda to a way that they could easily earn spending money. She had also introduced Linda to cocaine, so it was soon a necessity that they have money to spend. Late at night, the two girls would sneak out their bedroom windows and meet up halfway between their houses. They would make their way to a bar on West 7th Street in St. Paul that featured go-go dancers in cages late into the night. No one ever asked. Linda and Beth would just jump in and start dancing. At the end of the night, they would collect all of the money that had been thrown in the cages and head home. For the young high school women, this was a lucrative venture. No one ever seemed to care that they snuck out of their houses or into the bar. No one ever asked their age. They just did what they did and went home. It was also with Beth that Linda found herself attending dances at the prom ballroom. The massive event center was a place like none other in St. Paul during its time. With a lounge and bandstand, it was the place to go. Acts like Glenn Miller, Frank Sinatra, and the Everly Brothers all made appearances at the prom ballroom. Linda and Beth spent a lot of time at the ballroom, sneaking drinks from older friends, doing drugs in the parking lot, and dancing the night away to whatever band happened to be playing. 16-year-old Linda fell head over heels for a singing guitar player who graced the stage one particular evening. She found him after his set and learned that he was 20 years old and a teacher at a school across the river in Wisconsin. Despite their age difference, Linda and the guitar player struck up a romance. He would come to St. Paul on the weekends and take Linda on dates. Together, they had big dreams of a big future. Linda was only 16 years old when she found out the singing guitar player had gotten her pregnant. It was devastating news. She knew without a doubt that if she told her mother, she would be kicked out of the house. Linda was terrified. With no place to turn, she looked to friends for advice. One such friend, who had also found herself pregnant, was headed to New York to have an abortion. It was their high school social studies teacher who had made all of her arrangements, and Linda asked for assistance as well. The two young women flew together to New York City, where they both had abortions. When she returned from her trip, Linda became extremely ill. Her mother barged into her bedroom one morning when Linda did not get up for school. She was in too much pain and was too weak to get out of bed. She knew something had gone wrong with the abortion, but she was terrified to tell her mother. As her mother whipped her with a police belt for not going to school, Linda wept. She couldn't possibly tell her mother why she was so ill, but she couldn't manage to pull herself from her bed either. Finally, her mother realized that Linda was quite sick and took her to the doctor. Once in the safety of the doctor's office, Linda was able to get help. She received a procedure to remove the infected remnants of her pregnancy, and her mother was never informed about what had happened. Linda eventually graduated from St. Paul's Henry Sibley High School. She wasn't the first in her class, but she also wasn't the last. After all of her struggles, it had been a remarkable accomplishment for Linda to receive her diploma. After graduation, she tried taking the path of others her age and signed up for classes at a small technical college in the southern suburbs of the Twin Cities. She was adept at acting and speaking, excelling in her debate and public speaking classes. But while she didn't hate her classes, Linda realized quickly there was no path to making big money in a career she would find from staying in school. Linda wanted to make big money. During her high school years, Linda learned a lot about life from her friend Beth. With thoughts of college in her rearview, Linda looked to Beth for guidance on how to make a living. By this time, Beth was living in New York City, working in a criminal ring operating a con game. She was earning fast cash doing a pigeon drop con, and as it turned out, Beth was looking for a partner. With the promise of money on the horizon, Linda jumped on a plane to New York to meet up with Beth and learn how to work a con. When she arrived, Linda met up with Beth and they began working their scam. The game was complicated, but the payout was worth the labor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.